Guilty.
And to count six, aggravated child abuse, a second-degree felony.
With my deepest regret and sorrow for my family and my children. Guilty.
Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to Therapy Today. My name is Isaiah. I'm a licensed professional counselor. And today, I think we are finally putting a bow on the Ruby Frankie / Jody Hildebrandt cases. I don't know that for sure because new updates seem to keep coming out, but this one especially I wanted to touch on because the Law and Crime Network's video focuses on Ruby Frankie's plea deal and how because of that plea deal, she seems to be throwing Jody Hildebrandt under the bus and agreeing to testify against Hildebrandt in her upcoming case. So because Hildebrandt was a therapist, and I think at this point she has voluntarily given up her license in the state of Utah, I wanted to dig into this plea deal and see really what that means for Jody Hildebrandt, what we can learn about counselor identity, about what's appropriate to do as a counselor and what's not appropriate to do. And I think there's a lot on that side of what not to do as a counselor in Jody Hildebrandt's case. As always, make sure to like and subscribe. That helps us to continue to grow as a channel, and also make sure that you can stay up to date with all the content that we're putting out. I'm not gonna go through the entire 25-minute video, but I'll be picking out some clips that pertain more to the mental health and professional identity side of things. If you want to check out the whole video, go to Law and Crime Network. With that said, let's dive in.
But then you fast forward to last Friday, and Frankie's law firm indicates that she is going to enter into a formal plea deal, a formal plea agreement. They released a statement, and this statement was very illuminating, but there was one particular point I want to emphasize for purposes of our conversation today. It says, quote, Ruby Frankie is a devoted mother and is also a woman committed to constant improvement. Initially, Ms. Frankie believed that Jody Hildebrandt had the insight to offer a path to continual improvement. Ms. Hildebrandt took advantage of this quest and twisted it into something heinous.
I want to pause on that real quick because that statement, Ms. Frankie believed that Jody Hildebrandt had the insight to offer a path to continual improvement. Depending on how much you believe their lawyers are just spinning a story to make Ruby Frankie look better, this is generally true for people who are seeking a therapist or a counselor. And as you see in the following sentence, Ms. Hildebrandt took advantage of this quest and twisted it into something heinous. I think that's really illuminating because clients need to understand what they're looking for from therapists. And if this is what they're looking for from therapists, then therapists also need to recognize the responsibility and the trust that's being placed in them to not take advantage of that. And that's why we have these ethical principles like non-maleficence, not doing harm, and understanding what our duty is to these clients who are looking for this from us.
Over an extended period, Ms. Hildebrandt systematically isolated Ruby Frankie from her extended family, older children, and her husband, Kevin Frankie. This prolonged isolation resulted in Ms. Frankie being subjected to a distorted sense of morality, shaped by Ms. Hildebrandt's influence.
Also important to note, yes, counselors and therapists can play an outsized role in shaping someone's sense of morality in this case, sense of priorities, what's important in life and not important. And that's why as a counselor, I'll always refer someone back to their community, back to either their spiritual or religious community or the beliefs that they hold, because my values should not dictate how you act. And so sometimes my clients will ask me what they think I should do, and I'll always refer them back to, what does your scripture say? What does your church teach? What are the values that you hold as an individual or as a family or as a community? Because those are actually what should be shaping your decisions, because I don't want you to become a clone of my values. You should more and more reflect the values that you hold, and your actions should line up more and more with those if the counseling is going as intended.
Okay. So really putting the blame in a big way on Jody Hildebrandt. But then you go to Monday, December 18th, and Ruby Frankie officially pled guilty in the 5th District Court in Washington County, Utah, in front of Judge John J. Walton. She pled guilty to 4 of the 6 charges, 4 counts of aggravated child abuse. Each are second-degree felonies.
Ms. Frankie, how do you plead to count 1, aggravated child abuse, a second-degree felony?
Guilty.
To count 3, aggravated child abuse, a second degree felony.
Guilty.
To count 5, aggravated child abuse, a second degree felony.
Guilty.
And to count 6, aggravated child abuse, a second degree felony.
With my deepest regret and sorrow for my family and my children. Guilty.
Now, there is no agreed upon sentence in this plea agreement. The judge will ultimately sentence Ruby Frankie. And based on the way that I read the terms of this plea agreement, he has discretion. It seems that she could be sentenced to the maximum on each count, 15 years, and the sentences for each could run consecutively, meaning one after the other. Not necessarily saying that is what would happen, but it'll be interesting. And after reading what
I do have a question about that. So if you're talking about the maximum sentence for each of those counts, and I think she pled guilty to 4 out of the 6 counts, you're talking about a max of 60 years in prison, which I don't know how old she is exactly, but I guess that's pretty much a life sentence. So I don't see what the advantage was in her taking a plea deal for 4 of the counts as opposed to 6 of the counts. I don't see what the advantage is for her. I guess the judge can choose to be lenient because she is taking the plea deal, but like you said, I guess that's not guaranteed either. So lawyers in the comments, please chime in below. Let me know what's going on here. What's the thinking behind taking the plea deal for guilty on 4 of the counts instead of disputing it in court for all 6?
I read in this plea agreement, I wouldn't be surprised, though, if she's hit with significant prison time. Ruby admitted, and this is in the plea agreement, that she abused the children, such as kicking her son while wearing boots, holding his head underwater, cutting off his oxygen by covering his mouth and nose, tying him up with handcuffs, forcing him to stay outside in the sun during the summer months. This was over a 3-month span. He suffered significant sunburns. Her daughter faced similar treatment, and she was forced to run barefoot on dirt road. She suffered blisters and scabs. I mean, this is just truly unthinkable. This is horrible, horrible stuff. But she is also accused of indoctrinating the kids to believe that they were evil and that this was all for their own good, presumably with the help of Jody Hildebrandt.
And that is a piece that you find in abusive parent-child relationships where the outsized punishments, frankly, in her case, it seems like torture methods, are framed as being for the child's own good.
Great. Now I'm the bad guy.
Because they have this evil that the parent is trying to purge out of them through these punishments. And you heard something very similar when we reacted to Jesse Hildebrandt's interview, where they were talking about how Jody had much the same kind of argument, like there's this evil within you and I'm punishing you so you don't go that way, so you don't behave in those ways, when a lot of those things were made up entirely.
And that brings me to the next part, because it states in this plea agreement that Frankie agrees to testify against Jody Hildebrandt.
But the plea terms are relatively simple. She pled guilty to 4 counts of aggravated child abuse. The state agreed to dismiss the 2 other counts of child abuse. And she agreed to serve a prison term, and that the term for the 4 different counts will run consecutively and not concurrently. And she agrees, I'll read this one verbatim. She agrees to testify truthfully against Jody Hildebrandt, and in return, the Washington County Attorney's Office agrees to remain neutral regarding future hearings before the Utah Board of Pardons.
Okay, so that's the summary of what's going on with Ruby Frankie's hearing up to this point. So that was actually a lot more cut and dry than what they were presenting earlier in the podcast, saying that per the terms of the plea agreement, the sentences will run consecutively. So she is looking at a longer time spent in prison rather than if they were running concurrently. And she's agreeing to testify against Jody Hildebrandt. So then this podcast also brought on the reporter, Brian Schnee, who has been following this case out in Utah, local reporter. And so let's jump ahead to that spot where they bring him in to get his insights.
Her plea is being negotiated. We talked about this. So the fact that we got this seeming confirmation from her law firm with that statement, what was your reaction to it?
Not surprised, based on the initial, email I got from them a few weeks ago saying that they were hoping to reach a resolution shortly. I think it's interesting because you have to let the process, play itself out, as you know, Jesse. So it was really interesting to see that all of the things that we talked about in terms of a potential plea coming actually coming to fruition today, where they're expecting to, defense and prosecution come together and ultimately have this plea agreement. And I'm told that the court proceedings today should be relatively quick. That's not to say some of the things that will come out today could be particularly heinous or really tough for some people to process at home.
They did say earlier on in the video that they recorded this prior to the actual hearing. So at this point, when they're talking about heinous things might come out, they didn't know the full contents of the plea deal that we saw earlier. So the video itself is not in chronological order.
Now, again, I'm teasing up because we haven't even gotten into what this means for Jody Hildebrand. I want to get there in a minute, but I first want to talk about this statement because you and I haven't had a chance to talk about it. I read you a portion of it, which I think when we're talking about Jody Hildebrand, it's the most essential part. Throwing her under the bus, putting the blame on her. Now, what is your reaction to that part? Because, you know, there's one thing for her to take a deal and plead guilty, essentially, to her crimes. But to put the blame on Jody Hildebrand, that was something. What'd you make of it?
You know,
my reaction is that it's a logical thing to do. And I'll get into this later, especially considering their relationship. I know that at one point they had a professional therapist and client relationship, and over time it got twisted and evolved into like family friends and like business partners. So I don't know if she was still functioning in a therapist capacity with Ruby Frankie, but when you are working with a professional, they are held to a higher standard in terms of the privilege and the responsibility that they hold. Yes, I would be liable if I told my clients to do something, or if I was shaping them and shaping their morality, like they said earlier, in a way as to encourage them to do something wrong.
No, I guess I'm not surprised, because based on a lot of our reporting over the last few months, the people that we have spoken to had similar stories about Jody Hildebrand: manipulation, isolation, separating of couples as it pertains to ripping apart marriages. That is, in essence, if you look at the timeline, that happened to Ruby Frankie too. Kevin filed for divorce. And then obviously there's the other parts down the line where it happened to do with whatever is involved in this child abuse portion.
Yeah, that's a good point. Looking at the pattern of the victims who have come out in recent months about Jody Hildebrand's practices and how she liked to practice. Here's a tip that I feel like I shouldn't have to say, but if your marriage counselor is advocating for separation from your spouse, they're not really working towards you two getting back together.
Which apparently, you know, depending on how you look into these things, a lot of people have looked at the YouTube videos over the years and said, hey, some things didn't seem right even before Ruby met Jody. However, over the last 3 years or so, isolation from family, isolation from Kevin and Frankie, isolation and then other tactics with children, a lot of that is in line with what we've heard about Jody Hildebrand for more than a decade now.
I will say this, even if Ruby Frankie did show some problematic tendencies in her parenting prior to beginning her work with Jody Hildebrand, if any of their counseling work revolved around her parenting, that was on the professional, in that case, Jody Hildebrand, to be able to call her out on this and say, this is not appropriate, this might merit a call to CPS. Let's think of a more helpful way, a less harmful way, to be able to teach these lessons to your kids, not enabling her behavior, and certainly not starting a company with her and teaching how to parent in that same way. So regardless of whether these tendencies existed for Ruby prior to meeting Jody Hildebrand, there should have been some intervention once they did meet up, and not enabling.
I mean, we did a sidebar on this over the weekend when the news broke, and I was playing a few clips from Jesse Hildebrand, our interview with Jesse, who is Jody Hildebrand's niece. And those themes of isolation, manipulation, control were so consistent with that statement from Ruby Frankie's law firm. I, too, wasn't surprised. But from a legal point of view, it's so interesting, because I don't know how effective that would have been if they both went to trial together. If, you know, throwing Jody under the bus, because there was an aspect of the charges that that Ruby faces, that as long as you knew about the abuse and you allowed it to happen, you yourself could be convicted. So I didn't think.
Yeah, what he's talking about is mandated reporting. So if I'm seeing a client and they say like they abuse their kids, then I have a responsibility to report that. And that supersedes the boundaries of confidentiality that exist in a client and therapist relationship, because you're talking about the well-being and the safety of children, other people, that CPS needs to be involved if I have any kind of suspicion or concern about that. And it's not up to me to decide like, oh, this isn't that bad. No, the responsibility is on me to make the call, and then social services would determine whether or not to follow up on it. And so I think that's what he's talking about, that within that relationship, even if Jodi Hildebrand hadn't said anything about it, that would still be negligence on her part because she had a duty to report that.
I think, Brian, I'm not surprised hearing this, but I'm also not surprised that this is no longer, or seemingly no longer going to trial, because that wouldn't have been a successful argument.
Yeah, and I agree with that. And based on the conversation you've had with Jesse Hildebrand, and I have also had with...
So we're going to skip ahead a little bit now to where they actually talk about how all of this affects Jodi Hildebrand, her identity as a mental health professional or former mental health professional, and her case.
Now, let me just ask you what the main question is. What does this mean for Jodi Hildebrand? The last time you and I spoke is she has a separate waiver hearing. What is the latest that you have heard with respect after Ruby's law firm has come forward with this statement? She's about to seemingly enter a plea deal, plead guilty. What does this mean for Jodi Hildebrand?
Well, this means there's a lot more heat on Jodi, but maybe it does play in Ruby's favor that her hearing is first, right? And all of this is coming out first. The statement points towards Jodi. There's about 10 days between the two different hearings, and I still have yet to hear back from Jodi's representation, which I haven't since the very beginning of all of this. I mean, we have tried to at least get an inkling of how are they perceiving things. Compared to Ruby's attorneys, they have at least replied to some of our inquiries, and you know, we've had conversations, and we have looked to this day, which is where we ultimately got the language in their statement first to be able to share with everybody. But it was one of those things that I'm still waiting to hear from the person representing Jodi Hildebrand where they stand in all of this, because today has a big effect on what happens 10 days from now. And it would be really interesting to see how they are processing this whole thing, to which, again, at the time of you and I talking here, I did reach out again this morning just to say, hey, I'm in town here. I would love to get a little perspective from you about where things are right now. But it's been relatively silent. And as you and I have talked about, most of this, with the exception of the first 15 days or so, after all of this happened in late August, and then their initial appearance in early September, went really quiet, right? All we were hearing were people coming out of the woodwork, select family members, people that had experiences, mostly with Jodi, by the way, that you really hadn't heard much other than having to assume that both sides are looking at the discovery from the prosecution, and they're going to come together and likely strike a deal, because it didn't look like they were going to move forward to push towards trial at this point. It doesn't seem that way for Jodi either.
So you think there's a strong possibility that if let's say December 27th actually stays, that Jodi Hildebrand would actually plead guilty as well? Because you have to imagine, if she doesn't, Ruby Franke could potentially be a huge witness against her. For me, one of the things that I'm thinking about as well, the kids would have had to testify at a trial. And I think that's a major consideration for why Ruby Franke pled guilty. That's why I also think prosecutors might be open to accepting some sort of deal for Jodi Hildebrand to make sure that these kids don't have to testify at an upcoming trial. But you tell me, do you think it's likely, whether or not that hearing stays, whether or not the hearing is delayed? I mean, this is a very big development.
Okay, I didn't think about that as I was asking earlier, that might be able to keep the kids off the witness stand. And, if she was considering that as part of why she would take a plea deal, that maybe doesn't seem so advantageous. I can respect that for sure. But as to Ruby Franke testifying against Jodi Hildebrand, though I hope I'm never in this situation, this would be one of the reasons why you don't form outside relationships with your clients as a counselor. It helps to keep those worlds a little bit separate. And so if I just have a counseling relationship with a client, and then I do something in terms of malpractice or I'm doing something incorrectly, then yes, they can testify to what I'm doing inappropriately within my professional capacity. But if they were also my friend, if they were also hanging out with me on the weekend, that also muddies the water, because then am I more their friend? Am I more their therapist? How are they relating to me in one environment versus another environment? Should I act like a therapist to them in every environment, even though in some cases we might be friends and in some cases we're not friends? It just really messes things up when you start having multiple relationships with clients. And that's not to say it's always wrong. Sometimes you can't avoid that. Like, I live in a relatively small town. People who live in rural areas, there might only be one counselor in town, and there might only be one church in town, and sometimes those worlds are going to overlap. But but trying to think through what is best for the client and not what is best for yourself in those situations. That's what's important.
You think it's potentially likely Jody Hildebrandt could plead guilty herself?
As an educated guess, based on what we're seeing, I do believe that this, what we're seeing with Ruby, could very well happen with Jody. And I do think a lot of it lies on the kids. They have been very careful with how the children have been treated through this entire thing, which I've been trying to be totally respectful of, because I understand. I mean, a new dad myself, the last thing I'd want is for my daughter to be roped into any of these things, right? If it ever came to that point, you don't want to provide any further harm towards these children than they've already been thrust into the spotlight, and you've already heard about the emaciation for two of the children, the horrific 911 call from the neighbor saying, hey, I just came across this kid who had ties around his wrists and his ankles. Having any of these children have to relive that in the form of taking the stand, I think would be very damaging for the rest of their lives if it already hadn't been, based on a lot of this. So I do think we see something similar with Jody down the line here. But you're right, things could very well be delayed after things take place today, because what happens today directly impacts Jody Hildebrandt.
I also need to make a reminder that, like, when, I forget exactly which kid was found by the neighbor who escaped from the house and was still tied up with the zip ties or whatever it was, that was at Jody Hildebrandt's house. Ruby Frankie was entrusting her former therapist / business partner / family friend / whatever with her children. And so if you talk about, like, mixed up relationships, this was the very definition of that. I can't imagine any situation where I should be watching one of my clients' kids.
To be clear, again, we haven't seen the hearing yet for Ruby Frankie as we're recording this. Do you know if any representative from Jody Hildebrandt, her lawyers, anybody is going to attend this hearing and be aware of what happened? Because I don't even know if Jody Hildebrandt has been working around the, you know, behind the scenes trying to work out a deal, if she was hit by surprise at this statement from Ruby Frankie's lawyer. We haven't heard anything either. So I'd be very curious if you know if Jody Hildebrandt, any her lawyers, anybody, are actually going to attend Ruby Frankie's hearing today.
You know, it's not clear if they will, but I'd have to imagine, given the connection between these two, right? The friendship, the business partner, the whatever, and the fact that Jody's attorney has an office, you know, relatively close to the courthouse here, I would really have to imagine that they would be sitting at least in the courtroom listening to what takes place today. Or maybe they already have a heads up on how this thing's going to go if they've worked together in any way. And it's a lot of those things that we don't know because, you know, they just don't talk about those things, right? But it's one.
He mentions it. I can't imagine how hard. I have a lot of empathy for Jody Hildebrandt's lawyer, because they faced such an uphill battle, and now they got to deal with what's going on with this plea agreement, where Ruby Frankie, who shared a lot of life with Jody Hildebrandt, is now going to testify against her on top of all the other victims who have spoken out in the past. Like, they are facing an uphill battle. I don't know how they plan on pulling that off.
One of those things that we are waiting to see the exact paperwork on, right? This agreement, once it is filed into the system, I do obviously have the expectation that Ruby Frankie will spend more time in jail, and that this is not getting off scot-free at all because, right, of the admission here or whatever she's pleading forth. But I wouldn't be surprised if we did see anybody, even if it's family or something like that, related to Jody Hildebrandt, that will be there at the hearing for Ruby Frankie on Monday, December 18th, coming up here as we are talking in just a few hours.
And that's what I want to kind of end the conversation on, in terms of, yeah, I agree with you. I can't imagine a deal where Ruby Frankie would get no time behind bars. Specifically, there was this part in her statement where it seemed that she said she would support Kevin Frankie's ability to get custody of the kids, paraphrasing a bit. And that would seem to me to suggest maybe she's not going to be around. The bigger question is, what would happen with Jody? So, again, these are very serious charges. Now you have Ruby throwing Jody under the bus, which, as we've been saying, is consistent with what we've heard from other people. If Jody were even to enter into a deal, I would have to imagine whatever punishment she receives would be much worse than Ruby Frankie. Would you agree with that?
Based on the understanding that we have for how this is going to proceed with Ruby, I would really imagine that Jody will take the brunt of this. Based on what we've heard from, go back to Jesse Hildebrandt, I asked her directly months ago, would you say that Jody was the mastermind between all of this? And she said, yes. Based on the people that I've talked to about Jody, all of this screams Jody's tactics and how she has approached individuals over the years, whether it be couples that have gone to them for counseling, whether it had been somebody way back when that was referred through the church prior to things blowing up in that standpoint. I would have to imagine that if there are extra charges to give, they would likely go towards Jody Hildebrandt.
And I'll add this too, that again, because she's in a professional capacity, that she was the professional in this case, even if these weren't ways that she normally worked, she had a responsibility once she noticed that there were problematic things going on in Ruby Frankie's family to say something about it. That's part of what we're paid for, is to be able to challenge our clients, to be able to say those tough things. They might not listen to us, they might not heed us, or they might fire us in response if they don't like what they hear, but it's our job to speak up about it and for counselors out there to document that we said something about it, that we confronted them about it. And that's part of the tricky thing too, is that based on what I'm hearing from a lot of these other videos that we've reacted to about Jody Hildebrandt and how she worked, she liked to stay behind the scenes in a way. She would hide behind the authority of the LDS church that would refer members to her to be seen. She created this connections classroom to teach parenting and things like that. And for some of it, had Ruby Frankie be the face of that. So finally, her role in a lot of this, as they alluded to in talking with Jesse Hildebrandt, now she's getting dragged to the spotlight, and the patterns are being more clearly seen. And that's why I do feel like there needs to be more of a balance in some way between the confidentiality that's necessary for the counseling process to occur, but there are also to be transparency and openness about how that process is supposed to work. And that's part of what this channel is about, so that I can speak into cases like this and say, like, hey, you should expect better from your therapist. You should know that this is not how things are supposed to go, and this is how an ethical professional should be behaving or should be acting. And that will change, again, based on some circumstances and individual styles. But there is a baseline of ethical practice that we should expect from our mental health professionals. And she clearly was not meeting that expectation.
Hildebrandt, based on a lot of the conversations that we've been having with people that had past experiences with her, and how Ruby does point the finger here, at least in this statement from her attorneys, it does make sense that there's kind of this uneven balance here between what has been going on. Keep in mind, the children were found at Jody's house. So it's all these things that lean more towards Jody in a way than they do towards Ruby, even though we do know that Ruby spent an ample amount of time in Ivan's. We did see the video of her pulled over for speeding, 5 days before all of this really shook down. She was in Ivan's again. So there is that obvious connection between she was there, obviously very well knew what was going on, but I do believe all of this was spearheaded, as it seems based on people that we've talked to, by Jody. So I would have to imagine those charges are going to be heavily levied against Jody Hildebrandt.
And even in the police documentation, they suggested that Ruby had filmed a video with Jody in that residence 2 days before these arrests were made. Now, I'll finish up the conversation by just saying again, when you see this video, everybody, when you see my conversation with Brian, we will know the answer, presumably, about what Ruby Frankie. But I think all of this still applies, because we are most likely not going to have an answer about Jody Hildebrandt by the end of the day. This is going to continue on. Brian, you've been doing incredible work. Thank you.
So I guess you heard it from him. I guess we're not done following the case, because Jody Hildebrandt's hearing is still coming up, especially as it relates to counselor identity. That'll be really important for us to talk about. I will say that from what I understand, these kinds of licensure hearings where Jody Hildebrandt lost her license, those are not legal proceedings, but those are more kind of private proceedings between the board of licensing, or whatever it's called in Utah, and the individual. So being stripped of her license is not a legal consequence. It is a consequence of Jody Hildebrandt's actions and patterns, but the actual legal consequences are still forthcoming for her. So what are the important takeaways for this? I think it's important to know that counselors, therapists, if you are in the mental health field yourself, or if you're a client of a mental health professional, to know that there are certain ethical standards when it comes to abuse and neglect, when it comes to safety for yourself or safety for other people. Confidentiality does not cover that. Your therapist is not supposed to keep those a secret for you, because the well-being of yourself and others are potentially at stake. And there are going to be times when your counselor should be challenging what you're doing. If all they're doing is saying, hey, you're doing great, I completely agree with what you're doing, you should do more of it, you don't need a counselor anyway. So I think those are some things to take away from this case so far. And again, I'm not a legal expert, so I'm just following this and trusting their analysis. But lawyers, go ahead and comment below what your thoughts are on this plea deal and how that affects the case for Jody Hildebrandt. Again, the purpose of these videos is not just to get views or get clicks because this is a big story. It happens to be a big story because of the implicit trust that we put in mental health professionals that was clearly violated in this case from the way Jody Hildebrandt handled her actual practice, from how she handled these multiple relationships with Ruby Frankie and ended up harming a lot of kids in the process of that, not to mention her history of harming a lot of couples and individuals in her own work. So a lot of that is to spread the awareness about what you should expect from your therapist. Thank you so much for tuning in. Again, please like and subscribe so that you can continue to get updates on this content as we continue to cover this story and other stories and talk about what it means to have a good therapist, to have an ethical practicing professional. Really appreciate y'all's support so far. Thank you for tuning in, and I'll catch you all next time.